Namaste. We start with the prayer. Sri Krishna Vagishayatishvarabhyam Samprapta Chakram Kanabhashasaram Srinut Narangendrayatau Samarpitasvam Sri Krishna Maryam Guru Varyamide Virode Kartike Mahase Shatatara Krito Dayam Yoga Charyam Krishna Maryam Guru Varyamakam Bhaje Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Namaste. In this segment, we are going to see how the Pranayama is going to help in this situation. What is the role of Pranayama in increasing our resistance power? And what is the role of Pranayama that also helps our mind to become calm and quiet? As we know, Pranayama is the fourth limb of Ashtanga Yoga. It is one of the important connection between the gross side of Ashtanga Yoga and the subtle side, Bahiranga Sadhana, the external practices, and Antaranga Sadhana, internal practices. It is very, very important because this is the formation for all the Hatha Yogic practice. As we know, the Hatha Yoga centered in Pranayama practice. Ha and Ta, energy merging, that is called Hatha Yoga. How it is going to help us, we will see in this segment. So our human system works based on the priority. Whatever the prana available, it uses that prana based on the priority. Prana is the life energy, that which is responsible for our life. Without that, we cannot do any activity, that we know. Any energy, it is the form of prana. So the prana is very important to survive. How our system functions? Our system functions based on the availability of the prana. Whatever prana available to the body, it works based on the priority it sets. The first priority is the respiratory system. If I have little prana, that prana is used for my respiration, or otherwise I will not live. So whatever prana available, the body first uses that prana for my respiration. After the respiration, it uses for the circulation. Whatever prana available, it has to circulate in the body. After circulation, the priority is for digestion, because we need more prana. To produce the prana in the body, the available prana has to be used. So the third priority is digestive, and after digestion, whatever the nutrients, the energy is transported throughout our system. After that, the prana, available prana, is used for evacuation. Whatever is not required in the body, it is being eliminated from the body. Then if the prana is available, it is given for our healing purpose. So body works based on priority. When whatever prana is available, it works based on the priority. So the last one, the least priority, is the healing. But what we need is to take that healing power in us. So for that we need to do some technique or some practice so that we can have more prana, so that the system works in a priority basis and that prana is available for healing. For example, if I earn little money, what I do? I buy the food so that I can survive. If I earn little more money, then I will see to wear some cloth, so I buy some cloth. If I have little more money, then I will see I have to reside somewhere, so I will see a good house. If I have little more money, then I will buy other things. So whatever is available, I see only how I have to survive. The same way, the prana, whatever is available in the body, that is used in a priority basis. If my prana is very less because I am not able to breathe properly, then what happens? First thing, it starts working on my respiratory system. When that prana is in the respiratory system or using for the respiration, other organs' functions are compromised. If I have little more prana, it will work on breathing and circulation. My other organs are get compromised. So always there is a energy crisis. So first thing what I have to do is I have to increase my prana so that it is available for my healing after all the systems are taken care of. Pranayama is one of the important regulation of the breath so that we get more prana inside the body so that I can strengthen my healing property. Only if I strengthen my healing property, I can have my immune system available to me so that I can, my system can survive and it can fight from any external attack from the pathogens or bacteria or viruses. So first priority for me is to strengthen my healing property. Pranayama is one of the important technique to take more prana so that I can strengthen and I can have more prana to cover my immune system. So this is the background why we have to do pranayama. Not only in this time, in this period, any other period also, to have a very good healthy life, we need prana to be more in the body. That is why some of the text, the classical text says, the human's life is not based on number of years they live, it based on number of breaths. They say 21,600 breaths if you take every day, your life will be, healthy life will be 100 years. So our breathing pattern should be regularized so that we can have a long healthy life. and pranayama is given as pranasya ayamaha pranayamaha, that is extension of the prana or expansion of the prana or to draw in the prana. One of the texts, the Yoga Yajna Valkya Samhita, says our prana moves little away from the body always because there are impurities in the nadis, the channel in which through the prana moves. There are some blockages. Because of that, the prana is outside the body. They say a measurement, they say 12 angulas, around 1 meter around my body, my prana is away. The definition of yogi as per the text is whose prana is inside the body. So my aim of pranayama is to remove the blockages so that the prana can enter in the body and prana can come closer to the body. By regular practice, I should make the prana inside the body. So when I am very happy or I am very calm and quiet, my prana is inside. When I am depressed or when I am in very bad shape or I am in excited pace, my prana goes away from my body. So there is a direct connection between the mind and the prana. So the state of the mind and the movement of the prana is linked. So if I want to calm the mind also, I have to do pranayama. When my breath is regulated, my mind also regulated. When my breath is disturbed, my mind also agitated and disturbed. When my breath is calm, quiet, uniform, subtle, my mind also becomes very calm and serene. It is being given in the text Hatha Yoga Pratipika. It says, Chale vate chalam chittam nischale nischalam bhavet. It is clearly explained the connection between the prana and the mind. So pranayama not only helping to boost my energy or strengthening my immune system, it also helps to calm my mind. Because no other technique where you can do something with the mind. Because we can't see the mind. We can indicate brain, but the mind we can't see. But we know if something happens in the mind, it has the reflection on the breath. Or something happens in the breath, it has a reflection on the mind. So through the breath, by prana, we can address the agitation of the mind, especially in this period of time, mind get agitated, there will be lot of anxiety about the present and the future, and we cannot think rightly and we cannot act in a right way. So we take decisions with the anxious mind, we do some action with the disturbed mind, and it leads to dukkham or pain, suffering. So pranayama helps to calm the mind becomes serene, pious, so that it can take right kind of decision. The decision can be based on the right kind of perception through the calm mind. And there are some prerequisites given in text. For pranayama, you have to master asana practice. That doesn't mean you have to master all the postures. By doing asana, it helps you to sit in a straight position, the spine erect position, for a reasonable long period, so that your pranayama practice will be uninterrupted by the disturbance of the body. That is one of the prerequisite. Another prerequisite is aharam, the food, the diet. In present day, we have to take the right kind of food that helps us to strengthen our immunity. It helps us to give lot of nourishment to our body. So diet is one of the important criteria even for the practice of pranayama. And we must have a reasonable control over the senses. Then only the practice will be in a right way. The last one, very important, is Guru Upadesha Marga, that is the guidance of the teacher. Because the right type of pranayama helps us to remove all the diseases and disturbances. If we do inappropriate pranayama, instead of relieving the diseases, it invites the diseases. So the importance of the teacher is given as one of the prerequisite of pranayama. So this is some prerequisite given in the text Hatha Yoga Pratipika before doing pranayama practice. Very interestingly, in the same text, whenever they are explaining the benefit of each pranayama, they will explain the benefit and added that provided you take sattvic food. So the diet is insisted upon pranayama, because without the diet regulation, we cannot get the benefit, the right benefit, or claim the benefit of the pranayama. So it is very important to do some asana practice before doing pranayama, and diet control, and within the capacity of the practitioner, we have to do the pranayama. We should not go beyond our capacity. We must accept whatever level we are. From that level, slowly we have to move to the goal. Because each one's starting point is different. They will not have the same starting point. One is little better, they are practicing for a little long time, their capacity will be little more. Somebody is started little later, their capacity is different. So whatever pranayama we are going to do, we have to be very careful. It should be within our capacity. It is in Sanskrit, it is said, yata shakti. Your capacity has to be recognized and it should be regularized. So based on that, we have to do all the pranayama practices. So we are going to introduce some of the techniques that is going to help us in strengthening our immune system and also help us to make more prana inside the body. Interestingly, the Patanjali's Yoga Sutra says, what is pranayama? It says, changing unconscious pattern of breathing into conscious pattern of breathing itself is pranayama. When I am talking, I am breathing. when you are listening, you are breathing, but both are not consciously done. When I start focusing on my breath, when I am conscious of my breath, it automatically increases. So whenever I find time, whenever I am free, I start observing my breath, it automatically increases the prana in my body, because I am doing deep breathing, it helps to take more prana inside my body. So as we see that the conscious breathing itself helps in increasing the prana inside the body. So what I have to do is, whenever I find time, I do some conscious breathing. That will help. It is an easy way. Another way of how we do breathing is very, very important. How we have to inhale and how we have to exhale. First thing, place one palm on the chest and one palm on the abdomen. When I am inhaling, I have to expand my chest and also my upper abdomen comes up. On exhale, I relax my chest, then I contract my abdomen. I will do one more time. Inhale, there is expansion. Exhale, there is a contraction. Slowly I contract my abdomen and I also relax my chest. One more time. Inhale. Exhale. So this is how we have to do the breathing, so that we are using both thoracic and abdominal cavity. Both has to be used, the thoracic and the abdomen. Both has to be engaged when I am doing the breathing. So we are today going to see some of the techniques where it helps us to remove the excess toxin in the body, especially the mucus accumulation in the throat or in the windpipe or in the nostril area, wherever the excess accumulation of kapha, what we say in Ayurveda, or the mucus accumulation. The first technique what we are going to do is Kaphalabhati. The Kapala means skull, Bhati means to shine. So this technique helps us to remove the excess mucus in the path of the respiratory system, throat and the nasal area. This is one of the important technique. We must know how to do this technique correctly and how many times we have to do. This is also very important, and by using this technique we can remove the excess toxins in the system and also having more prana inside the body or the system. So I will just demonstrate to you how to do Kaphalabhati. The thing is, here exhale is active, inhale is passive. That means normal breathing, our inhale is active, exhale is passive. In this technique we are reversing, that is my inhale passive, my exhale fast. I will just demonstrate. So here what I have done is, exhale fast, I have just given a gap so that the inhale happens automatically. I have not taken any pressure or any effort to do my inhalation. I just did my exhalation fast and I have given a small gap so that the inhale happen automatically. One more thing about Kaphalabhati is, we should not do Kaphalabhati by taking one breath and pushing exhalation 2-3 times. I am going to show this. This is not the correct way. So everyone has to understand what is right and what is wrong. Now I am going to demonstrate that which is not correct. Inhale once. This is not the right way. Kaphalabhati is just exhale fast. This is the right way, where you exhale fast and you give a gap so that your inhale happens automatically. And how many times I have to do? So it depends upon the person's capacity. Normally in our tradition, we don't do Kaphalabhati continuously for 3 minutes or 4 minutes. We do, but in a different way. We do some 12 Kaphalabhati, then take some 3 or 4 breaths, normal breath, then 12 Kaphalabhati, then have some 3 or 4 breaths in between, or you can choose to do 24 Kaphalabhati and 6 normal breath. This forms a round. Then you can do 4 rounds or 5 rounds according to your capacity, because doing more than what it requires also not good. That means we go beyond our capacity. So slowly start with whatever capacity you can do. For example, I can do 12 Kaphalabhati, then I will have 4 normal breath. Then 12 Kaphalabhati, then 4 normal breath. Like that I can do for 6 rounds or 7 rounds till I feel better, where I can able to feel lightness in my head, I can feel lightness in my body, I can able to see my respiratory system, the pathway is completely open. This is one of the best way to remove whatever the toxins or accumulation of kapha, excess accumulation can be removed. So to improve our condition or improve or strengthen our immune system, first thing we have to remove the toxins or whatever is not required in the body. So Kaphalabhati helps. Another pranayama is Bhastrika, where my both inhale and exhale both are fast. The difference between Kaphalabhati and Bhastrika is, Bhastrika I do only fast exhale, my inhale is passive. But in Bhastrika, I do both inhale and exhale fast, and it also one of the best way to remove the impurities in the body. And this is one of the best pranayama technique to balance all three humors, that is Vata, Pitta and Kapha. The Hatha Yoga Pradipika clearly says the Bhastrika pranayama helps to balance all three doshas, Vata, Pitta and Kapha. Now I am going to show how to do Bhastrika. One more interesting aspect of Bhastrika is, in Kaphalabhati the focus is on the abdomen. In Bhastrika, the focus is on the chest. Just observe me. So this is one way of doing Bhastrika, where you are inhaling and exhaling both fast. But sometime what happened, you will not able to focus on the chest. So to have a focus on the chest, this Bhastrika can be modified, that is inhale fast, exhale fast through alternate nostril. So I am having a nostril control on my exhalation, the fast exhalation in Bhastrika. Just observe how to do that. I have the Mrigi Mudra and my chin down position. So by focusing or regulating the exhalation on my nostril, the focus shift to my chest region. So we have seen how to do the Bhastrika Pranayama, where you are inhaling and exhaling, no control. But next I have given one more technique where inhale fast, exhale also fast. But we have some control on the nostril, so alternate exhalation with the fast Bhastrika. So this is also one of the important technique to remove the excess toxins or excess mucus, that which is not required in the body. And these two techniques also helps us to have more prana inside the body. Because when we are doing Kaphalabhati, we have the stroke, very fast exhalation, and we are taking prana, but not too much, but little, but more times we take the prana, so that the prana in the body become adequate. The same way in the Bhastrika also, by doing this fast exhale inhale, the number of breath is more in each minute. That means we are taking more prana inside the body. But one important aspect we have to take care, that these two pranayama also have some contraindication. Those who have high blood pressure, that is hypertension, they should not do these pranayama. Those who have hernia, the inguinal hernia, or the hiatus hernia, they also should not do these two pranayama. When the pregnancy period, you should not do these two pranayama. When somebody has the epileptic seizure, the stroke, they should not do this pranayama. When somebody has low back pain, they also should not do this pranayama. So these are very, very important factors we have to take care when we are using these two important techniques. They make all the impurities or the excess toxins or the kapha to go away. Also helps us to have more prana in the body. It also helps in removing the blockages in the respiratory system. So it should be done in a proper way. So my advice is, do 2 minutes of Kaphalabhati, not continuously, but 12 or 24 Kaphalabhati, then give a 3 or 4 or 6 normal breath, then 24 Kaphalabhati, or give some 4 to 6 normal breath, or 12 Kaphalabhati, or 3 or 4 normal breath, according to your capacity, till 1 or 2 minutes. After that, another 2 minutes, do Bhastrika same way. Do Bhastrika some 12 or 24 times, then have a gap. Do some 6 to 10 normal breath, then do Bhastrika then have 6 to 10 breath, normal breath, like that you continue, do for another 2 minutes. So 4 minutes you do this Kapalabhati and Bhastrika, then comes the important pranayama called Nadi Shodhana Pranayama or Anulom Vilom. So Nadi Shodhana, the name itself indicates, it cleanses the passage through which the prana moves, the nadis. Nadis are the subtle channels through which the prana moves. But because of some lifestyle changes or our not following the right type of diet or some external factors, our nadis are blocked either physically, mentally or emotionally. So this technique helps in removing these blockages so that the prana can move adequately inside the body to the all parts and to the all system. So the technique given in the Hatha Yoga Pratipika, where you inhale through the left nostril, hold the breath, exhale through the right nostril, then inhale through the right nostril, hold the breath, then exhale through the left nostril. Interestingly, the text talks about inhale left nostril, hold. They have not given how many minutes you have to hold, but they have the indication after inhalation you must feel the breath from your top of the head to the nail in the toe. That is, head to feet, you must feel the prana. Till such time you have to hold the breath. Then exhale through the left nostril, right nostril. Then inhale through the right nostril. Hold in the same way. Then you exhale through the left nostril. This is how the text has been given, but we have to be very careful that we should not do that much of hold until we reach that level by our regular practice. So initially what we can do is, instead of holding for too long, we can hold up to 6 seconds, or somebody practicing this pranayama for a long period of time, they can hold for 10 seconds. Inhale, exhale, there is no ratio. Just inhale through the left nostril, hold for 6 seconds, then exhale through the right nostril, inhale through the right nostril, hold for another 6 seconds, then exhale through the left nostril. This is what we can start with, then slowly we can increase the hold from 6 seconds to 8 seconds, and over a period of time 8 seconds to 10 seconds, then 12 seconds. Like that we improve ourselves so that slowly we can reach the goal. So I am going to show you how to do this Nadi Shodhana Pranayama. First we have to have this mudra called Mrigi Mudra. If somebody can able to do this, or you can have a simple mudra like this, these two fingers, it's also enough. Whatever is comfortable for you, you can do that mudra and place it where the bone meets the cartilage in the nostril. Then slightly chin down with the back erect. Then in exhale completely both the nostril. Now inhale left nostril. Then hold the breath. Exhale right nostril. right? Hold the breath. Exhale left nostril. One more time. Inhale left nostril. Hold. Exhale right. Inhale right. Hold the breath. Exhale left. Like that, we can start with 6 rounds, then we reach the 12 rounds of Nadi Shodhana Pranayama. This is one of the important pranayama. The Hatha Yogic text says it removes all the blockages in the Nadi so that the prana is moving all over the body, so it balances the system. Very interestingly, the text Yoga Rahasya by Natha Muni, it says other pranayama has specific benefits, but Nadi Shodhana pranayama has innumerable benefit, that is immeasurable, lot of benefits we get by practicing Nadi Shodhana pranayama. So this you can start with 6 rounds, then reach up to 12 rounds, or if you are able to do, you can do up to 24 rounds also. It depends upon your practice, how many years you have done this pranayama practice. Start with those who are earlier, they are starting now, they can do some 6 rounds initially, then slowly they can go to the higher levels. The text Hatha Yoga Pratipika says one must practice this pranayama 4 times a day. Early morning, midday, afternoon and midnight. But midnight it is not possible nowadays. So the Yoga Rahasya says at least 2-3 times a day. Morning, midday and the evening. So when I do 3 times, and they also say 40 rounds for each time. That is the ideal, the goal they have given. But we can start whatever level we are, we can start with 6 rounds. Also do for 3 times a day, morning, midday, evening. By doing this pranayama, we are regularly removing the blockages in the nadi, so that the prana can move all over the body at all times, and we can have more prana. More prana inside the body means our healing property is also strengthened. Whatever the internal organs function, it is being improved. Whatever damages happen inside, it start curing on its own, because the prana is available more in the body. So Nadi Shodhana is one of the important pranayama. So what we have to do is, I have already told 2 minutes of Kapalabhati, 2 minutes of Bhastrika, at least 12 rounds, start with 12 rounds of Nadi Shodhana. It can end up to 24 rounds of Nadi Shodhana with hold after inhale. That hold must be within your capacity. Start with 6 seconds. If you are practicing this for a long period of time, if your breath is little long, instead of 6 hold, you can hold up to 10 or 12 seconds. It all based on your capacity. You must try, and if you feel comfortable for these 12 rounds, then fix that as your practice. If you are doing with 10 or 12 second hold, after 3 or 4 rounds you feel little difficult, then reduce the hold component. So we have to see on ourselves how my body is responding to these practices. Then I can do within my capacity, yata shakti. So 3 pranayama I am told. Next is Surya Vedana. This is also one of the important pranayama given in Hatha Yoga Pradipika, where we can see how to do the Surya Vedana. So Surya Vedana pranayama given in Hatha Yoga Pradipika, where it says inhale through the right nostril, hold the breath, exhale through the left nostril. The hold, it says yata shakti, that is up to your comfortable level you have to hold the breath. It is also very important, because all these pranayama in the Hatha Yoga text says all are called kumbhaka. So kumbhaka means hold, but kumbhaka also means pranayama. Both are synonym. So it says do pranayama or do kumbhaka, especially the Surya Vedana pranayama, where you inhale through the right nostril, hold the breath till your capacity, yata shakti, then exhale through the left nostril. Just I will demonstrate how to do. We establish this Mrigi Mudra or whatever mudra is comfortable for you. Back straight, chin down, place the fingers on the mat, that is where the bone meets the cartilage. Then exhale completely. Inhale right nostril. Hold the breath. Exhale left. Inhale right, hold the breath, exhale left. So this is the way you do the Surya Vedana Pranayama. The hold, as I already said, it is depending upon your capacity. Either you hold for 6 seconds or you can hold for 12 seconds or 10 seconds, whatever the capacity you have. So we have to be careful about the holding component, because the hold after inhale, we may exceed our capacity. So we have to be very, very careful. Whatever capacity I can able to do, 6 seconds or 8 seconds or 10 seconds. So this Surya Vedana Pranayama, I have to do either 12 rounds or 24 rounds, depending upon your need. So this is very important, because the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, the text says the Surya Vedana Pranayama kills the bacteria or pathogens in the brain region or in the head region. So this pranayama helps to strengthen my immune system. It also removes that pathogens that comes inside my body. And this has to be done with very careful hold after inhale within my capacity. So in my suggestion will be, after Nadi Shodhana Pranayama, you can do 12 rounds of Surya Vedana starting with. Then go up to 24 rounds of Surya Vedana. So what we have done, first Kapalabhati for 2 minutes, Bhastrika for 2 minutes, the Nadi Shodhana 2 to 3 minutes, that comes around some 7 or 8 minutes, then 2 minutes of Surya Vedana. So 10 minutes of this practice. After that we have done lot of Brahmana practice till now. We have lot of Brahmana means activation. Hold after inhale, and we have focused more on the hold. So we have to make our body and the mind come to a neutral state. So at the end we can do at least 6 or 12 rounds of Sheetali or Sheetkari. Sheetali is where you are inhale through the rolled tongue and hold the breath, then exhale through the nostril. If those who are not able to do with the rolled tongue, they can do with through their mouth, where the teeth are clenched. I just demonstrate Sheetali, where you protrude your tongue, then inhale. So I inhale through the protruded tongue and hold for 3 to 4 seconds, then exhale through my nostril. One more time. Those who are not able to roll their tongue, they can do Sheetkari. First clench the teeth and place the tongue behind the teeth, then inhale. Like that, we can do at least 10 to 12 rounds of Sheetali and Sheetkari, so that my system become now neutral. Instead of always activating, I also make my body and the mind calm. So what we have seen through Pranayama, how we can improve our immune system, how we can encourage our healing property to be in the highest level of functioning. For that we need to take more prana, because as we already said, there is an energy crisis happening always inside our body because of not having adequate prana. So this capsule of practice, where 10 to 12 minutes or maximum 15 minutes of practice, you can do, start with Kapalabhati, after that you do Bhastrika, then Nadi Shodhana Pranayama, then Surya Vedana, after that end with Sheetali and Sheetkari, at least morning and evening. Two times, if you do 15 minutes of Pranayama after your asana practice, it will help not only to improve the immune system, it also helps to calm the mind, it also helps to remove all the toxins, that which is not required in the body. I think this will help in a small practice of Pranayama, so that you can have a very healthy body and the mind. Thank you. Namaste. Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha.